For Indian kids, learning how to play guitar and simultaneously reading something like history used to be a distant dream. But not anymore. The new education policy is out with some reforms in order to make some very extraordinary changes in how we teach our kids in the new education system. So let's go and have a look at the positives as well as the negatives of the new education policy which has been launched recently in the year 2020. I have been trying to figure out what the new education policy is trying to say and what are the positives and negatives of the education policy. But surprisingly, since yesterday, even after watching 10-15 videos and going through a lot of news articles, I have been able to, or I was able to figure out only some patches of the education policy, and that's why I decided to take some more time and get into the details so that from educational purpose, not only from an understanding purpose, but also from educational examination purpose, you can understand how the national education policy can be very useful for you to score high marks in the examination. It's an oxymoron here because the national education policy tries to get us rid of the fear of examinations, the idea of rote learning, but at the same time, we are trying to, or we will try to rote learn some of the aspects of National Education Policy 2020 in order to score high marks in the examination. So let us go to the education policy through this PPT and try and understand what are the areas which are basic in nature, which you can remember without actually making an effort, and what are the areas which will require you to put an effort in order to remember and recall them at the right time during the examination. Okay. Before actually getting into the policy 2020, let's try and understand the history of this education policy. The first policy was launched in the year 1968 based on Kothari Commission, which was set up in the year 1964. And the second education policy came in 1986 under Prime Ministership of Rajiv Gandhi. 1968 policy, as I said, was based on Kothari Commission report, and it is surprising that even at that point, Kothari Commission report said that we need to spend 6% of our GDP on education. This was because China had at that point in time already started investing very heavily in education, and understanding that or realizing that, Kothari Commission also recommended that India do the same, but it was a distant dream. We did not follow it up. The public expenditure on education in 2017-18, as per the economic survey of 18-19, was 2.7% of GDP, which is not even half of what is expected out of a country like India. But remember, there are two things here: public expenditure on education as a percentage of GDP and public expenditure on education as a percentage of total government expenditure. When we talk about government's total expenditure, then it is 10%. But when we talk about total GDP, then it is 2.7%, even less than 3% mark. Okay, so this is all about the brief history of education in India. The question that can come in the examination, rote learning, as we say, is the Kothari Commission. What was the main purpose? When was it formed? What were its recommendations? Okay, the new National Education Policy came out yesterday, and it is based on draft prepared by K. Kasturi Rangan Committee, also called as K. Kasturi Ranjan. Ministry of HRD, as per this policy, is to be renamed as Ministry of Education. This has been a very long demand of some states that humans should not be treated as a resource anymore, and therefore the work of Ministry of HRD should be transferred to another ministry, which should be called as Ministry of Education. So instead of creating a new ministry, what has happened now is that the Ministry of HRD has been renamed as Ministry of Education. So it's a positive sign, but at the same time, if the actual working of Ministry of HRD does not change, then there will be no advantage of changing the name itself. Okay. Another basic feature of the National Education Policy is that medium of instruction is going to be local language till fifth class. Please remember this, although it's a little controversial, this feature or this provision or this recommendation, because, for example, if there is a student of class fourth, okay, and he is, let's say, Bengali studying in West Bengal, and now his father gets transferred to, let's say, Delhi or let's say Mumbai. Okay, and let's say he goes to Mumbai, and in Mumbai the medium of instruction in class fifth is Marathi. So now he is going to understand nothing because the medium of instruction is Marathi, and it was Bengali in the first case. Please understand the difference between medium of instruction and the languages which are going to be taught in schools. English will remain one of the languages in schools, but the medium of instruction is not going to be English anymore if the policy recommendations or the policy vision is accepted by a new law. So there's a difference between medium of instruction and languages taught. Medium of instruction means I am teaching you right now in English. This is medium of instruction. Let's say it becomes Bengali tomorrow, or it becomes Hindi tomorrow. Let's say if it is Hindi tomorrow, this is a real problem. A lot of students from southern part of India complain that they are unable to understand whatever I'm teaching, and they already face a dearth of good quality videos on YouTube which can teach them everything in English. So the medium of instruction has as much importance as the language is taught, and even more importance, because that is the only way the teacher is communicating with the students and the students are communicating with the teachers. So it is said that the medium of instruction can be local language till fifth class, but it is a little controversial at the moment. Okay. Now, what are the pillars of the new national education policy? There are five pillars. You can remember it very easily through this acronym AAAEQ. Another method of rote learning, very opposite to what the vision of this education policy is. AAAEQ. A is access, accountability, affordability. Access means everybody gets it. Accountability is if the teacher is not teaching well, the teacher is held accountable. If the student is not learning well, the student knows that there are some problems with him. Accountability. Accountability of teachers, accountability of principals, accountability of the administrative staff. Everything needs to be very clear. Affordability, more easy access to all the people around the country. This is something which is actually not followed in spirit in the policy itself, because it encourages private non-profit, trust-based schools in India. Now, all the schools in India have always been non-profit trust-based, but at the same time, they are too expensive for the reach of middle class or lower middle class. But the policy does not recognize this, and it goes further and even encourages private non-profit trust-based schools to be expanded in India. So this is a negative because it goes completely against the pillars that have been identified in the policy itself. Equity, number four, which is that everybody should get the same kind of education, whether you're studying in a private school or a public school, and quality of education. That means the quality should stay the same, and at the same time, the quality has to be very high or very good. So these are the major five pillars. Let us see whether the policy justifies these five pillars in the spirit, in letter and spirit, or not. Okay. Now, what are the things that you can remember very easily, and you don't have to put in a lot of efforts in order to remember these points? Number one, universal access. The policy says that instead of providing guaranteed education to students in the age group of 5 to 14 years, which was as per Right to Education Act 2009, now the policy says that from age 3 to 18, we will try and provide universal access to education. Although it is not yet a part of Right to Education Act, that needs to be seen whether they do it or not, but the policy says that we need to provide universal access to education from the age group of 3 to 18. The new curriculum has been created. The older curriculum was 10 plus 2, which was based on board examinations. The board examinations are still going to be there, but the new method is, or the new curriculum is based upon 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4. This is where a question lies. Again, rote learning along with understanding completely going against the policy vision itself. 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4. 5 is age 3 to 8, 3, 4, age 3, 4, 5 is pre-nursery, where it's like a play school kind of a thing. So that has also been integrated into the formal education system. It used to be out of the formal education system. There was no standard curriculum. Play school, whenever you would put your kid in a play school, you would see that every play school is teaching something completely different. It's completely based upon what they feel is good for the kid or what they feel is something that they can teach. So there was no standard curriculum, but now it has been brought into the formal curriculum system of the country. So age 3, 4, 5, pre-nursery, and then 6, age 3 to 4, 4 to 5, 5 to 6, and then 6 to 7 and 7 to 8. 2 years are going to be in school, pre-nursery and something like that, KG. And then you have 8 to 11, 3 years, which are going to be schools. So these are going to be called as foundational years. Then these are going to be called as preparatory years. Age 11 to 14, another 3 years. These are going to be called as middle years. And secondary, age 14 to 18, that is going to be 9th, 10th, 11th, and 12th. These are going to be called as secondary years. So this is how now they have divided it. Questions can be asked from the entire chart that I have placed here. 5 years, then 3 years, then 3 years, then 4 years. 5 years, age 3 to 8, foundational. 3 years, 8 to 11, preparatory, then middle, then secondary. Please remember this. Total of 15 years, 3 years Anganwadi, as I said, Anganwadi or play school, and 12 years of schooling, class 1 to class 12. Okay, this is how the system is going to be. We will talk about the changes that have been brought in board examinations with respect to how the board examinations are going to be conducted. Class 6 onwards, coding to be made mandatory. This is a very positive step. You don't need to remember it. I'll tell you also how all this information is going to be useful to you. So please stick around. I'm telling you simultaneously what are the areas wherein questions can be asked. And then I will also tell you how this not so important or information that you don't need to remember, how is it going to help you in the exam. Internships and projects to be made mandatory from class 6th again, which is very good. For example, you learn how to garden, you learn how to be a plumber, you learn how to be a carpenter. These small vocationals are very good, not because they are helping you earn, but because they are helping you understand the practical aspects of various jobs that you do. Okay, introduction to all subjects of all subjects from 6th. So 6th onwards, all the subjects are going to be introduced to you so that you can understand them well. And by the time you reach class 11th, you can then decide what do you want to study. Okay, 9 to 12th, division into streams to be removed. So in 11th, we had to choose whether we want to have commerce, whether we want to have science, and whether we want to have humanities. It is very interesting because I was equally confused when I came in 11th class. I took science first. I did not understand anything out of chemistry. It was completely alien to me. I could understand physics. I could understand maths. I loved biology, but chemistry was considered to be an important aspect of biology, and I understood nothing from chemistry. So I had to drop it after 1 month in the same class itself. Then I took humanities and I found no interest at all in history at that point of time, although I love it now. So I dropped that again after 15 days, and then I took commerce. So it's a very confusing time for a lot of students. And a lot of times the schools don't encourage you to experiment. I was fortunate enough that my parents and my school allowed me to change streams because I did not like what I was studying, but that does not belong to everybody. So this is a very good step because now students can experiment with different kinds of subjects. You like accounts, you take accounts. You like biology, you take biology. It's going to be lovely. A national curricular. So whatever I have highlighted, these are the things that you have to muck up. Rote learning is in yellow. Okay, remember this. So jo bhi yellow mein hai ya phir jo bhi highlighted hai, all those things you have to try and remember. A national curricular and pedagogical framework for early childhood care and education for children up to the age of 8. What does it mean? Let me explain it to you. Aise kuch samajh nahi aayega, you cannot understand anything. As I had explained to you when we talked about these foundational 5 years, that there is no formal curriculum for the play schools. They can teach whatever they want. Therefore, now the policy says that there should be a central national curricular and pedagogical framework for early childhood care and education. So from class from age 3 to 8, these formative years of children should be formally identified, number one, and there should be a formal and standard pedagogical and early childhood care education system which should be set up so that every school, every play school or every kindergarten can implement those, and therefore the formative years of a child can be, or the foundational years can be made more useful. So remember this, NCP FECE, NCP is National Curricular and Pedagogical, FECE is Framework for Early Childhood Care and Education. Okay. Then multilingualism, this I have said is controversial medium of instruction in local language till class 5, and optional languages to be Sanskrit, other classical languages, foreign languages also to be introduced from class 9th, and English also to be one of the languages to be taught. Okay, for fun project or activity on languages of India sometime in grade 6 to 8, this is what it says, that languages of India will be promoted through projects and activities. Okay, what about equitable and inclusive education? What does it say? So when we talk about, let's go back to multilingualism, local language, optional languages to be foreign languages, Indian languages, classical languages, English as well. These two things that are the ones that you can try and remember. And then projects on languages of India from class 6 to 8. For inclusive education, the policy says that there should be special education zones, or there will be special education zones, just like special economic zones. So it's a good step if they can actually implement it and create education zones. It's a big problem in India because education is supposed to be a little more isolated from the hustle bustle of city life, so that students can innovate, can do what they want. And it's good that they've understood this, and if they implement it well, it's going to be transformative. Bal Bhavans as daytime boarding schools, this is also important because majority of students from the lower middle class and middle class are the ones whose parents, both of them, are working. And therefore, if they have daytime boarding schools which have good quality, it's going to be very useful for their education. Teacher recruitment, what does it say on that? Now, these are the things that you have to learn, rote learning, RL. NPST, National Professional Standards for Teachers. Now, this is a very positive step because B.Ed, Bachelor of Education, has been considered to be a degree which you can get while sitting at home. A lot of institutions are providing it seriously, but then there are, to be serious, to be very honest, there are a lot of institutions in India which are providing bachelor's in education, B.Ed, without actually asking you to regularly come to the college. Okay. So the quality is not at par with what it should be. And the National Professional Teachers Standards for Teachers, NPST, will make sure that this does not go on. So professional standards for teachers will be created, and these will be developed by NCTE, National Council for Teachers Education, and they have to be created by 2022. So another rote learning that you have to do. Standard setting body. Now, this is one major flaw of this policy, that there are too many bodies that have been created, and these n number of bodies are going to clash and are going to create confusion in the future. So unless there is a proper structure and flow, it's going to be a very problematic system to implement these policies in the future. State School Standards Authority, SSSA. This is going to be a standard authority which will create standards for schools for policy making, regulation, operations, academic matters. Okay, so standard authority for schools, a standard authority for teachers. School Quality Assessment and Accreditation Framework, SQAAF. This also should be in yellow. So this is accreditation framework, which means manyata prapt karna, manyata dena, matlab accredite karna. So accreditation framework is going to be separate from the standard authority. National Mission on Foundational Literacy and Numeracy. Details are not provided, so we are going to skip it for now. And then there are assessment reforms that have been brought in the policy by the name of PARAK. PARAK stands for Performance Assessment Review and Analysis of Knowledge for Holistic Development. Again, RL, rote learnings, you have to remember it. A new national assessment center is going to be created called as PARAK. It is going to assess the performance of teachers, the performance of students, the holistic development of students. Okay. Board examinations, as said, will focus on core concepts, will be made easier, the words of the policy itself, and students will get two chances to clear their board examinations. So the purpose is to reduce the importance of boards, but at the same time, there is a problem because majority of the universities and colleges are still reliant on the board exams scores. Unless they change their method of recruiting, their method of taking in students, the board examinations will not lose their sheen. Okay. Shift from summative assessment to regular and formative assessment. This is very good because it will teach students critical analysis. It is actually very not surprising, I would say, but very unfortunate that we as Indian students still don't know how to do critical analysis of our own work. This is something that I've been trying to teach for the last 2 years to students through some videos, but even now, majority of students don't understand how to critically analyze their own work. Okay. So I think this is going to be a good step for the future students. For higher education, what does the policy say? Gross enrollment ratio, the objective is to increase it to 50% by 2035. Presently, it is at 26.3. But the problem here is that they want to increase gross enrollment ratio through open learning and distance learning, majority of this. So in numbers, they will be able to increase the gross enrollment ratio by huge margin to 50% by 2035. But the problem is, because the quality of open and distance learning cannot be as good as the quality of regular learning, so the quality of these people who are going to be coming out from open schools and distance colleges will be questionable. Okay. I'm not saying they're bad, but there is a difference and it's expected. It's normal. There's a teacher teaching you every day in a regular college. And then there is a open school where you have to go once in a week or once in a month, something like that. Okay. Multidisciplinary education. This is very good. Let's say you enter an engineering college. After 1 year, you will get some credits and you can actually leave, drop out. And using those credits, you will always have those credits. And you can come to a university like, let's say, Delhi University or Mumbai University or Presidency, and you can enter that college, another college. All those credits that you earned in your first year and as an engineer will still stay alive. You can use those credits in order to continue your education. So this is very good. This is something that was followed in a majority of developed nations. And it's good that we are also adopting it. Okay. Now, these are the bodies that you have to learn. Isko ratta marna padega, rote learning karna padega. Higher Education Commission of India is going to be created and it will have four bodies. Number one, National Higher Education Regulatory Council for regulation. Number one, for standard setting, it's going to be General Education Council. For funding, Higher Education Grants Council. And for accreditation, as I said, manyata dene ke liye for National Accreditation Council. So this is for higher education. For schools, you had Accreditation Council and then you have had Standards Authority. Here you have four authorities, one for regulation, one for standard setting, one for funding and one for accreditation. Ye aapko yaad rakhni padengi. You have to remember these bodies. Okay. What about teacher education? So there is another body, NCFTE. National Curriculum Framework for Teacher Education, which is going to be created by 2021. And the purpose of this body is to create a new curriculum framework for teachers so that the teachers are regularly trained. And at the same time, when they enter teaching as a profession, they are very well qualified as teachers. Okay. By 2030, the minimum degree qualification for teaching will be 4-year integrated BA degree. So you will have either a bachelor's degree plus a 1 year or 2 year BA degree or an integrated 4 year BA degree. Okay. A national mission for mentoring will be established with a large pool of outstanding senior or retired faculty. I don't think this is going to work out. It's very difficult to actually, have community participation in something as professional as teaching or anything else. And therefore making it a mass scale movement kind of a thing where all the retired and senior faculty come in and train the younger teachers without any payment or without any advantage in return are going to do it. So they should have a standard body instead in order to do it, rather than trying to make it a mission kind of a thing. What about technology in mission? A National Education Technology Forum, another body, will be created to provide a platform so that use of technology in education can be encouraged. Now, this is something that is a positive step, although it's going to be seen how this actually is implemented on ground. Because if I tell you very honestly, I am in touch with a lot of lecturers in various colleges around the country. And although they're saying that they're teaching online, but in reality, how they're teaching online is just by using Microsoft Teams, softwares like Microsoft Teams. All those are good softwares, but at the same time, they're not meant for teaching per se. They're meant for, number one, meetings of corporates, or when you're teaching in classroom, then simultaneously you can use something like Microsoft Teams. But at the same time, they're not a replacement at a time like COVID. And online education, adopting it is not difficult. So if they stay in the same mode, UGC and other institutions who are implementing this at this point of time through COVID, then it's not, the quality is not expected to go to the level that is expected. But that remains to be seen. Promotion of Indian languages, setting up Indian Institute of Translation and Interpretation, National Institutes for Pali, Persian and Prakrit. Not very important. You can just try and read it once. GDP and education, one of the most important ones. It is said that it should be taken up to 6% of GDP, and at the earliest, there is no timeline given. And the Kothari Commission also said the same thing. So let's see if after almost 5 decades, we still are able to make this change or not in our education system by spending more money as a percentage of GDP. Affiliation of colleges is to be phased out. This is very important. So if you are in college, or if you have any friends in college, or if you have any younger siblings, or anybody who is due to enter college after some point of time, make sure that they're not entering colleges which are affiliated to certain university or certain certain kind of a degree course, but they are a part of central or state government boards, education boards. Because affiliation colleges will be phased out over the next 15 years, so that more autonomy can be granted to institutions that remain, because the quality is good of those institutions. And at the same time, the colleges which are affiliated and their quality is not good enough, they can be ruled out, they can be phased out, they can be closed, okay, so that the quality can be improved. So this is all about the National Education Policy. Now, as I said, that I'll be telling you how is this policy going to be important for you. I mean, which all perspectives can be used by you for your examination, upcoming examination. Number one, as I have mentioned, wherever I felt that there can be questions asked, so all the pointers, try to remember all the pointers, because they can be direct assertion reasoning type questions. For example, there can be 4 points. Okay. The new policy says that Indian languages will be promoted in the form of, by setting up Indian Institute, IITIs, Indian Institutes of Translation and Interpretation. It says GDP on education is to be increased to 6% by the year 2022, which is incorrect. It says as soon as possible and not by the year 2022. So these are the small, small things that they can pick out and ask you questions on. The second area that can be used from this education policy is in an essay. Okay, I'm specifically talking about RBI SEBI NABARD examinations. Then essay is the second area where this policy can be useful. You can mention some, so you can divide it into two parts: school education, what are the reforms in school education, what are the reforms in higher education, okay, then what are the reforms in teaching, and what are the reforms in learning. Similarly, what are the reforms in teaching and what are the reforms in learning? So this way I have created a very clear structure, and then I can start providing, okay, these are the reforms in teaching, these are the reforms in learning in school, these are the reforms in teaching in colleges, these are the reforms in learning in colleges. This way you can structure your essay very well, and you can explain the policy in a beautiful manner, okay? Please remember that for students who are going to write RBI SEBI NABARD examination or any other banking examination, that all these small pointers like Parak, what is the full form of Parak, what is the change with respect to board examinations, what kind of new curriculum framework is going to be adopted, 5 plus 3 plus 3 plus 4, what are the age groups in all these, what are the class groups in all these, which one is foundational, which one is secondary, which one is middle, which one is preparatory. All these things, all these small points are very important. So you have to try and remember these points, because this is where the examiner is going to confuse you by asking you questions from these areas. Okay. Overall, a good policy. There are some pros and cons, of course, some confusion, some controversies. Sports is not there. Extracurricular, although mentioned, but there's no specific direction as to how extracurricular should be promoted in India. A lot of art, a lot of culture in India, a lot of Indian instruments. There's a lot of focus on language, but what about the Indian musical instruments? What about other kinds of Indian cultural aspects which have been missed out? Painting, sketching, all those things. So those are the things which have been missed out. So if you're writing an essay, you can probably conclude by talking about these things that have been missed out. Okay. Overall, a good policy. Let's see how it is implemented over the next 5 to 10 years. For examination purposes, I have told you what are the things that can be useful. What are the ways in which you can try and remember the things that you have to remember and the things that you can't remember without trying to note them down and revising them again and again. Okay. All the very best, guys. Take care. And if you like this session, do not forget to subscribe to my channel and press that bell icon, because I keep coming out with regular videos on various issues important for your banking examination.